faith with that.
It's not all faith.
Who thinks?
God,
turning away from the things of this world and the things that are anti-God. And Lord, the revival would sweep and people would keep their eyes on Jesus, the hope of the world. Now God, as we have preaching and singing and worship tonight, my prayer is that you will bless in the midst of all the things that we do. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. What? It known.
You're right, buddy. It'd be like for those folks on Facebook that might not have heard that. Hey, God. Five texts already. They couldn't hear the prayer. You tell them I wasn't talking to them. I was talking to God. Huh? No, I did. That's right. But tell them I was praying for them then. I just wasn't talking to them. But I was talking to the one that mattered today. Amen. All right. For our mission moment that on Sunday nights, as we always do, we got two special nights. On Sunday nights, we take up a dollar and we give it to our WMU ladies and for all the mission work that just goes out of this church. And I mean, it goes out by the thousands of dollars all the time. Because of what you give just a dollar or two on, you wouldn't believe how God does that. And then on Wednesday nights, we start taking up a dollar and giving to the Gideon work. And they told us last Wednesday night that we had sent out over $200 worth of Bibles. We'd sent not just $200 worth of the Bible, we have sent out 200 Bibles into the world. And between what we were doing working in our church through the Gideons and through our WMU ladies, folks, we're doing a ton of money worth of work in the world we live in. And boy, I'm glad to be a part of a church like that now. It just makes me happy. Tonight I want to talk about a young couple that in Farmington, Massachusetts, named Brian and Jody Shippey. It says in 2017 that they planted a new church called Bonner Hill Church in Farmington, which is about 25 miles west of Boston. The church meets on the campus of Farmington State University. Because of such a strategic location, many Sunday students just walk into the worship service just because they're just wondering all around about it. When Brian and Judy met so many students who had no clue about Jesus, you know that up in the northeast parts of the United States, most of those don't have a clue, a real clue about who the real Jesus is. So when Brian and Judy met these folks and know that they had not a, it says here, they had no clue about Jesus. Now I could see that, India, Asia, somewhere, United States of America, Boston, Massachusetts, smartest people in the world, in that northeast corridor up there, and they have no clue about Jesus. That's right here where we live, folks. They began to look beyond their church. Now they're praying about how to make sure every college town in New England has a church, a gospel witness church. Boy, wouldn't that be amazing? Our church supports them and their ministry there in Massachusetts through the cooperative program that we give. We also share their concern with college students who will one day run their state and nation, will do so without knowing Jesus Christ as Savior, unless those who follow Jesus act. Does that not sound familiar to what we need in the world today? For those that run our government to know Jesus? Can we pray now for Brian and Jody and pray that the Lord will call many planters to come and help them in their collegiate ministries to share the gospel in the campuses all over New England. So I'm going to pray for them, and then our Mimi will come and lead us in our song tonight, and our ushers will come and take up our mission offering. Father, I thank you for this young couple that has taken their family to a place and stepped out on faith and followed you. And Lord, they've planted one church and have a desire in their heart to plant many of them. And God, I pray, you know, they said they're amazed at a place in the United States of America where there are so many people that absolutely know nothing about Jesus. Down where we live at, that's hard to understand. Because we're in the Bible Belt down here, and there's a church on every corner just about it. But there's not. And I think one of the greatest places, of course, where, Lord, our students needs to be reached is the students of this country. Especially the college students, where 80% of those professors that teach in the colleges are very liberal and they don't teach the Bible and they won't let the Bible be taught. So God, I thank you for this young couple that's planting churches where people can learn about you. So God, I pray that you would bless their ministry. I pray, dear God, that you would help them to share the gospel on these campuses all over New England. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Mimi, come lead us. Let's stand together as we sing soon, very soon. Going to come tonight. Got a little special. Got a little singing at the beginning and a little singing at the end tonight. Something that I requested of him to do. And thank God we've got folks that will come and stand in the gap. We need that help. And they're there. I asked Brother Ray several months ago, I said, "Can you bring a tape every time you come to church in case I need somebody to sing?" And he said, "Oh, yeah, I'll bring one." So, but I'd already asked him about tonight because I had one song that we could sing at the end I wanted to sing. But you come and you bless us now, Brother Ray.
Jesus on the cross, the people crying, looking for a man with faith. Such a tragedy. But what the world could not see was when they nailed him to that tree. He broke the chains of sin and set them free. Sprang up from man in misery.
Sin died where the blood fell. Oh, I'm so glad precious blood covers me.
Thorns of violence, thorns of hate, are growing wildly. All the pain that sin had caused was so very plain to see. But when the blood came streaming down that cross, where my Savior bled and died, he broke the chains of sin and set men free. Love grew with the blood fell. Flowers of hope sprang up from men in me. Sin died when the blood fell. I'm so glad his precious blood covers me. Sprang up from men in misery. Sin died when the blood fell. I'm so glad his precious blood covers me.
His precious blood covers me. Love grew where the blood fell. Brother, I'll tell you, I love that song. That's one of my all-time favorites. favorites. It makes me feel how wretched and undone I was. But yet he loved me anyhow. Amen. All right, I had kind of steered you away a little bit the last couple of Sunday nights from Daniel, because I wanted to tie some things together. Don't trip over this rug again. And I moved you to tie America with the greatest empire that ever lived, that ruled the world, the Roman Empire, and to make a comparison of the thing that brought the Roman Empire down to destruction and how America is going down the same path that the Roman Empire went down, that brought it down to complete destruction in the world that we live in. Now, as we get up and we are still in Daniel chapter 2, there's one thing that is clear by the prophecy of this chapter. Now, Daniel goes and interprets the dream of the king. And remember in that dream that he showed him four great kingdoms that would hold power over the earth. And he said the first would be represented by gold. The second would be represented by two arms of silver. Remember, he gave him showed him a picture of a 90-foot statue. That's how tall it was. The middle section of the statue was made of brass. And the feet was made of clay and sand, which was the foundation. And he says, this is the dream. And then he tells him, he says, King, you are the gold. You are the golden kingdom. You are the head of the kingdoms. But what Nebuchadnezzar was so overjoyed with the fact of him being the golden head and the head of these nations, he did not read the whole picture. Because the picture was this: you will be the first, but you will not be the last. There will be another kingdom that will follow you, represented by silver, which is the Medo-Persian kingdom. They will last for around 200 years or so, and then there'll be another kingdom that will take over the world, and they will be led by a man known as Alexander the Great. And he will rule the world for approximately 200 and some odd years, and then the greatest nation that the world has ever seen, and the one country that is going to come and rule the whole world, will be brought in by Rome and be known as the great Roman Empire. So he says in that picture of that statue are four nations that for the next 1,000 years or so will rule this whole world. And the Roman nation ruled this world during the time of the birth of Christ, and even some 50 years or 100 years after Christ's birth, did the Romans still rule the world. Now, these worlds, this picture that we're going to give you tonight of the stone, it tells him, if he had sense enough to see it, we know it, because this is history, this has already happened. He said there would be a stone that would come out of the side of the mountain that eventually would do what? Destroy and bring every one of these nations to their knees. No matter how great they are, they will fall to this stone. That's what he says. Look at me in Daniel 44 and 45. He's interpreting the dream. And in the days of these kings, So what he's saying to Nebuchadnezzar, he didn't say in the day of this king, he says of what? These kings. So what he's telling Nebuchadnezzar is what? Oh, you're going to be king for a day, but you're not going to be king forever. There'll be somebody to defeat you, there'll be somebody to defeat them. So he says to him in the Bible that in the days of these kings of these four nations shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. How many times in the Bible do we hear the term the kingdom of God? Jesus mentioned it time after time after time, didn't he? The kingdom of God. He says, after these kings have come and these kings have gone, there will always be the final kingdom, which is the kingdom of God. Not kingdoms, but one kingdom set up, which shall never be destroyed. So what he's saying in those scripture in there is what? Very plainly. Now, I'm not sure he's understanding all this because his head's done got about this big since they have told him that he is the gold. He is the top of the statue. And so he probably thinks he's going to rule forever, doesn't he? He is delighted at the picture that's been given to him. And he doesn't quite, I doubt, these words register with him. And he says, the kingdom of God will never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all of these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Very important verse of scripture in the Bible there. God says that no matter how many kingdoms there will ever be on this earth, know how many great nations, no matter how many great armies that there will ever be on this earth, there is only one kingdom that will stand forever. And that he will defeat all kingdoms that arise on the earth, and that one day the kingdom of God will become and be set up and God will rule the world. Now I'm sure that Nebuchadnezzar missed this part of the interpretation. I am sure that he did. For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands. Remember that word stone. He said there was a stone that will be cut out of the mountain, not by man. I thought about that this week. Now, I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, so I don't know if I'm right on this or not. But can you make a rock? I'm just asking you a question. Can you make a rock? Just make a rock. I don't know. I'm asking. Mr. Beal, I've been trying to figure it out. How do you make a rock? You don't, do you? When God created the heavens and the earth, the rocks were made then, right? There's no man that ever made a rock. We've used them, and we've made roads out of them. We've made driveways out of them. We've made every kind of thing in the world out of them. But no man ever made a rock himself. But I never thought about that in all of my years of living. I don't know. But anyway, he says this will be one that will be made without hands. How many times in the Bible is Jesus called the rock? What is the one rock that was never made with hands? Jesus. Why? Because Jesus always was. In the first verse, I'm actually doing this now. This is just for me. This is not for y'all. Being as how I don't have enough stuff to do to take up my time. I started each morning when I come to the office, and Brother Jack started over in Genesis. Just started this week. And I said, I'm gonna start just taking it verse by verse, where it's kind of like I'm doing. So I ain't got to the message yet, and all my half my time gone, right? So I said, I'm gonna do my own interpretation of Scripture and write it out. I'll never use it. Lynn said, "Why are you doing?" I said, "You know, same reason they say people do crossword puzzles to keep their mind active, right?" So I decided, Brother Lynn, I'm going to start doing it Scripture interpretation. And so I did 6 verses Tuesday morning. I did 3 verses, 3 where I can't do fast. But I read through those things and go through every word in there, and if there's something there, and then I pray that the Holy Spirit just shows me something. And so I got it in there, and y'all will never hear it, but if I die and don't fly, y'all can look at it and say, "This is Preacher Jimmy's memoirs." They might make the best-selling list one day. I don't know. They might do good as Dr. David Jeremiah's books do. I don't know. But I'm writing my own interpretation. And then I listened to him. I said, "God never made a rock. The rock not made with hands." And then I looked in the beginning where it said, you know, everybody always tells me that if you can get past the first verse of the Bible, you can get past the rest of it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You see, in the beginning, I don't know why I'm on this. This ain't got nothing to do with Jack here. Except, there was no such thing as time until Genesis 1:1. Time did not exist. Time came into being the minute God said, "In the beginning." That's when time started. In the beginning, God. There had to be an energy of some kind to make things happen in the world, right? And that energy that did the creation was God. And God created now what we know as space. God created the land. But God was always way before that. Jesus was always way before that. The Holy Spirit of God existed before Genesis 1:1 ever was penned in the Word of God. So, this goes back to that scripture that I just read to you, that said this strong rock that's going to come out of the mountain is a rock that was never made by hand. Jesus Christ. I looked at that and I said, wow. Wow. For as much as I saw it, the stone that was cut out of the mountain without hands. Now everything else that was made, every rock, everything else that is in the world was a creation of God. It was made. But there was a rock that was not made. And his name was Jesus. And that it break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold. And the great God has made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter. The dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof is sure. He said all of these kingdoms are going to crumble under the force of that rock. Jesus. King, I hate to tell you, but your day is coming. Alexander, I hate to tell you, but your day is coming. Nero, I hate to tell you, but your day is coming. And every nation will be crushed and brought down by a rock that was not made with hands. I want y'all to remember that. Now, that may not excite y'all, or y'all may not have thought about that, or if you have, but that was a key thing to me as I looked at this and studied this. And I love what Daniel says here. You know what he says? It's kind of like my mama used to tell me. If I tell you the oven's hot, you go ahead and put bread in it. Because it's hot. He says, everything that I have interpreted to you is true. And everything that I have told you will come to pass. So he backs down. Or he backs away and he just tells him this. Now, I'm going to go hopefully pretty quickly with this. I buried a lot that I didn't plan on doing tonight with that other stuff. But let's look at this rock. I thought about the rocks in the Bible. I thought, and I wrote these things down. I said one of the rocks that is mentioned in the Bible is a smitten rock. And by that, this is what I mean, and you know that. You probably never know how important rocks were until you do a study. That's what I'm telling you. That's what I'm trying to do for my own personal knowledge, not for you. Every morning. Remember when Moses was in the wilderness? And the people were complaining and arguing because they didn't have any water. And God heard them, and God said, Moses, go smite the rock. The smitten rock. And Moses took his rod and tapped the rock. Remember, Jesus said, I am the water of life. And if you drink of me, you'll live forever. And he tapped that rock, and the water came out. The smitten rock. When you look at the rock there, you will also find over in 1 Corinthians 10. What Paul said about a rock. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10 and 3, they all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. That rock was Christ. He called the rock what? A spiritual rock. Now we tromp on rocks, we stomp on rocks, we walk on rocks every day of our life when you go out of your house to get in your car, when you go to the mailbox, wherever you go. You walk on a rock every day. But not the spiritual rock. Paul said that rock that he's talking about is a spiritual rock. And his name is Jesus Christ, is what Paul says. You see, that smitten stone in Exodus, let me tell you what that is. There are many things that happen in the Bible that are pictures of things to come. Brother Lynn knows this. He's probably preached this and taught this hundreds of times. There are many things in the Old Testament that are pictures of things to come in the New Testament. See, that smitten rock that was hit with the rod was a picture of Jesus Christ as he was smitten and stoned. And not only did the water come out, but the blood. Boy, you sang it, Brother Ray. Love grew where the blood fell. And the blood, listen, Ray, the blood fell because the rock was smitten. You didn't know you was going to go along with my sermon tonight. You sung that, did you? I didn't know it either then about 2 seconds ago. I didn't. But as that water gushed out of that rock and the blood rushed out of our Redeemer of the world right there, that spitting rock was not only the rock that sent the water for so the people could live, but it was the smitten rock, the spiritual rock of Jesus Christ, that the blood flowed that we might live. Not only was it a smitten rock, it was all a smitten stone, it was also a stumbling stone. In Romans 9:33, Paul wrote this. He says, "As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone." I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense. And whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Paul called Jesus what? A stumbling stone. So he was a smitten stone, as I have written for your notes. He was also a stumbling stone. What did Paul mean when he called him a stumbling stone? There's no name that has ever existed among mankind that has caused more interpretation, that has caused more confusion, that has caused much more uproar than the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus, the Bible says, is the name above all names. The name of Jesus is a name that the Bible calls a lovely name. The Bible says that one day that every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus is Lord. See, that is the one thing, that spiritual rock that has become the stumbling block to the world today. The whole world stumbles over the name of Jesus. Do you know that? Remember when I read to you the other week, that in our courier where it said when they prayed in the house there and they began this session of Congress, that when they prayed in the name of Brahma, which is the Indian god, and they prayed in the name of many other gods. Remember that? I read it to you, word for word. It's in my office in there. And they said at the end of the prayer, they said, "A man and a woman." A stumbling block. The preacher that read that or prayed that prayer, whatever, that ain't even a prayer. That didn't get as high as my kneecap when he said that. But he said it. And you know why he said it? Because he didn't know this scripture I'm reading you here. And if he'd have known the scripture and have been a half of a preacher, he'd have known that the name of Jesus is the name above all names. It is no amen and a woman. It is amen. Jesus said, when you pray, pray in my name. If you want to get your prayer's name, you pray in the name of the spiritual rock, who is Jesus Christ. But it's the most hated name. See, that's the stumbling block. That's the reason they took the Bible out of school. They didn't take the Quran out of school because it didn't have Jesus in it. They don't take the other trash they have all over the world out. But if you find something and put something in there that's got the name of Jesus in it, they don't want that in there. It's a stumbling block to what they want to teach. Just like those missionaries. You know what their greatest stumbling block is? And I don't even know them, but if they were to come here tonight, I'd sit down. What is your greatest stumbling block? And just what they said in that, what I read you, they've never heard of Jesus. Imagine the United States of America created under to be free where we could worship Jesus Christ and part of the nation don't even know who he is. And the other part don't want to believe that he's the Savior. That he is the one and the only way to glory. They don't want to believe that. We want to believe the falsified lie that is being preached in the great mega pulpits of this land, that anybody can go to heaven and there are many ways to go to heaven. Just do what you want to do and it's going to be okay. But I'm here to tell you, unless you go by the spiritual rock, you'll never get there. He's a spiritual rock. He's a stumbling stone. Number three, he's a special stone. He said, that rock that comes out of the mountain. Now, I want to tell you something. We don't hear much about it, and we don't think much about it. But in the world that you and I live in, stone is crucial, isn't it? Most everything, you think about it, that has a foundation has stone in it, doesn't it? Robin, when they have these foundations on these houses, and they make this cement stuff, they got stones in them, right? When they build those roads out there, if they don't meet a certain requirement with those stuff and have the right amount of gravel and the right amount of that stuff in it, they won't pass inspection. They got to redo them again because the stones have to be just right. It's a special stone. Jesus Christ was the most special stone of all, according to what the Bible says. In Isaiah 28 and 16, I don't know that I don't think I put this on your notes, but write it down. Isaiah said this, therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion a foundation, a stone, a tried stone. He's been tested. He's been proven. He's been proven. That's what Isaiah said. And then he says, a precise cornerstone and a sure foundation. It's a special stone. He that believeth this shall need not hasten. The only sure thing that you can count on in life is this. Well, I always hear people say, and it's a lie like most things people that make statements like this say, well, I can tell you it's two things you got to do. You got to do what? Die and pay taxes. Right. Die and pay taxes. Well, folks, I'm here to tell you, you ain't got to do neither one. That's a lie. Because the Bible says, now we all shall not die, but we shall be taken away in the air, scooped up by the Lord, never lose. And the Bible says, even if this old body dies, that the moment that you close, your old body goes, the dead in Christ are alive. You, a child of God never dies. I'm never going to die. I might leave you, but you know what? To be out of this world is to be with who? The Lord. He's a special stone. Isaiah said, he that believeth in that special stone. And then Isaiah called him this, what? A sure foundation. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. He's the sure rock. I believe this, that when you got saved, I don't care what you've done before or what you've done after. This is what I believe. When you really gave your heart to Jesus, that moment you gave your heart to Jesus and He wrote your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life, you became a child of God and you were set on a rock and you were on a sure rock that was going to get you to glory one day, no matter what happens in your life. That's what I believe. He's not an iffy rock. He's not a maybe rock. He's not one that like that at all. He is that sure foundation. I find as I looked at this rock, it very fascinating. Very fascinating. I not only had my notes, but look, I just wrote tons of notes along. Because the more I got into it, the more fascinated I got with it. He's that special stone. He's the stone that men have stumbled over and have gone to hell because they stumbled over Jesus. But He is that stone that is eternal. He is that stone that is eternal. Heaven and earth shall pass away. But He said, my word, who does the Bible say the word is? In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God. But my word will last forever, right? So He's a sure stone. He's a sure foundation. And in biblical days, this is what they believed. That every building would have one important stone in that building that they believed was the stone that kept the building from crumbling down. Have you ever watched them play this game where they put these blocks? I've never done it. I probably did when I was little. I just don't remember. Where they put all these blocks and stuff on top of one another and they keep pulling them out. Until all of a sudden, they pulled the wrong one out. And what happens? Humpty Dumpty fell off the wall. And it all came crumbling down. That's that cornerstone. Jesus in the Bible is called not only the foundation, not only these other stones, but more importantly, He is called the cornerstone. Nothing else works. Nothing else stands. Nothing else will stand up to what this world goes except Him. And that's why He's called the cornerstone. The cornerstone. Now, Daniel says something else about this stone. The last thing. He says this stone will be a smiting stone. Which means what? Well, this is so simple. What did he tell him? King, you're the gold, the other's the brass, the other's the silver, the other's the iron. But there's a rock that's going to come that's going to destroy all of y'all. Put all of y'all together and y'all cannot withstand that rock that is made without hands. Y'all cannot withstand that. Now, in my mind's eye, what this image represents is the governments of man throughout history. That's to me. This is a picture of man's work. And we all know, because we have just finished the book of Revelation, that God said that He is going to destroy this world. That He is going to burn this world. God says He is going to bring complete destruction to all of those that do not know Him as their Lord and Savior. That He will bring total destruction to all mankind. Now, if I'm Nebuchadnezzar, and then Daniel tells me what I have interpreted to you is true, and you can put it in the Bible, what that says to me is, enjoy the ride as king, because it will all come to an end for you one day. That's what he's saying to him. And it will come to the end of Alexander, and it will come. All of these will be great people. America will be great. Nations will be great. Russia's great. China's great, and all these. But none of them can withstand that rock that is going to come out of the mountain and destroy them and destroy this old nation as you and I know it today. It's going to be gone. That rock, don't forget that, mark that down. A rock not made with hands. I like to have a who's it fit when I read that. Brother Lindy, it ain't no telling how many times I've read that scripture. But then God said in my heart, said, this is a different kind of rock here, Jimmy. This is the rock. This is the rock. Capital R. And it represents the coming of Christ's kingdom. What he is saying to Daniel for that day is this. There's going to be a rock that's going to come out of the mountain, this Janus, and it's going to pulverize every nation. Every nation. And that rock is Jesus. It will pulverize you and all these other nations I've showed you. It's going to follow you, and it will bring that statue down to dirt. And he says to the world today, to the whole earth, that at the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, in the next 2 weeks, I'm going to be putting some things together. I've already got them. I got them outlined. I'll be doing the studying over them, and I'll probably have some more stuff to you. But I'll be talking to you about a rapture. And I'll be talking to you about a second coming. You see, at the rapture, the world's not going to be destroyed. I don't think. And you got to understand, I get in territory where preachers disagree when I begin in the next two sermons. There's going to be tons of preachers this world ain't going to agree with what I'm going to tell y'all. But I'm your preacher, so I'm going to tell you what I think. If you don't want to believe me, that's your prerogative. You can listen to some of them heathens on TV and believe what they tell you. But he depicts the coming here. Here we are, thousands and thousands and thousands. We're here, and what he is saying here has not even taken place yet. And that is the destruction of every kingdom. Remember in Revelation at the end of time, what does it say? That the nations of the world will gather in a place called Megiddo, right? Not a nation, not two nations, but he says that the nations of the world, thinking that they're going to go in and destroy the nation of Israel under the leadership of the Antichrist. I better get too ahead. I'll be ahead of in my teaching I got coming to you. But the Bible says that that rock that was not made with hands will come. And all the nations of the world that have been here in the tribulation period and have rejected Christ, that when at that time, all nations will be destroyed. All of them. Us, China, Russia, all of them. And then Jesus says that he's going to come and do what? Build a new heaven and build a new earth. Now, I believe that. That's my beliefs. And I'll be in more particular with you starting next Sunday night about how I believe and what phases these things take place and how they occur, and what happens. I'll be telling you that next week. But this rock, it shows us the second coming of Jesus Christ. It shows us that rock not made with hands. That rock that comes out of the mountain. You see, when you come out of the mountains, you come out from on high and you come down. And soon, that's why I told Mimi, I said, we got to start singing soon and very soon, because we don't want to be called as a church that's not standing here looking and waiting because he's coming. The Bible says if you look around, you will look and see that your redemption draweth nigh. We're closer than the average person wants to believe. If you think that God is going to let this sin and mess and all go on in this world and keep going like it's going on now, you got a bad mistake coming. I'm going to tell you that right now. And when they start bringing destruction to the church, which will be coming, well, once they get all this other garbage out the way, and they get all of us, I'm ready for my check. I'm going to send my check. But I want to be in that payoff when they send that, what's that check to go send? Huh? Stimulus. I can't never remember the name of that. I've got it, but it ain't never stimulated me. It takes more than that check to stimulate me. But I'm waiting for the trumpet. Well, Jay, I'm waiting for that shout where he says, come home, my child. Ain't no coronavirus up here. Your mama's up here. Your daddy's up here. Your grandpa and your grandma's up here. Let's have a big family reunion. We all go sit there at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And we're going to have the most glorious time. And I just think, you know, one of the glories, Brother Lynn, of being a pastor. I haven't been one long as you. But you just think about all the people that you've pastored over all those years. And all those that's gotten saved under your ministry. And all those that have been baptized. When those gates are opened up, you go walk in and they're going to say, that's my preacher there. That's the one that was preaching when I got saved. And that'll be the greatest reunion of hundreds of thousands of people that our mind down here that I can't even remember, but they'll remember when we get up there. What a day that's going to be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one that saved me by his grace, took me by the hand and lead me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day, that'll be. Amen. All right, I'm going to tell you about that day next Sunday night. I might even sing that to you next Sunday night. I might get so excited, I might bring a guitar, and I ain't never played guitar in my life. I never held a guitar. Jimmy, you reckon I could play a guitar? I can sing about good. I can call your name. There's a lot of people in here I can say that about, including me. But now it's prayer time. We're through. That's the message. Got through it quicker than I thought it would. But we're going to have prayer time. But before we do, I ask Brother Ray to come. We talk about the altar a lot. He's going to come now. Sing one of my favorite songs. That's what the altar's for. All the gospel songs I've heard, and I love a lot of them. But every time I hear this song, it makes me want to pray because I know that I've got somebody that needs my prayers. I need my prayers. So Brother Ray's going to sing. That's what the altar's for. And when he gets through singing that, we're going to have a prayer time. We're going to pray for our nation. We're going to pray for our church family. We're going to pray for other people. That's the church, folks. If you need to pray with the preacher, he'll be here too. He'll pray with you too. All you got to do is come and take his hand. Brother Ray, that's what the altar is for. Thank you.
just as my own without one plea.
The service is nearing an end. The choir is singing just as I am. Now as the old song is played, people at the altar kneeling down to pray. Some are finding mercy, forgiveness for their sins. Some are fighting battles they're struggling to win. The time has come to give them to the Lord. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry your burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. Jesus is waiting, waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. That's what this altar is for. The Father is praying for his son. A mother kneels beside him, thanking God they've come. An old man is standing there in tears, giving up a part of him that he's held back for years. Hearts are being broken, lives are being changed. Those who call upon him, they will never be the same. The time has come to give them to the Lord. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. Jesus is waiting. He's waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door. That's what this altar is for. That's what this altar is for. You don't have to carry your burden anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. Jesus is waiting. who's waiting here for you. Go quickly now, before they close the door, and you can give your burdens to the Lord. That's what this altar is for.
Family, loved ones, and I always say this, if we don't love them enough to pray for them, they may never change. But we ought to love our children, our loved ones, our moms, our dads, our people we work with. And you pray right where you are. Your prayers will get up to heaven just as much there, but that's what the altar's for. For those that can get here and come and pray. God, I thank you that in the Bible, the altar, just like we talked about the stone tonight, was an important part. And almost, listen, when an altar was built, it was built, how? With a stone, a living stone. Smitten stone. Jesus is that rock. God, we got people we love tonight. We got husbands, wives, children. That God, that we care so much about. That God may need that touch from you tonight. There may be some different paths that need to be taken. God, I pray that they, as we come together, as your word says, if two or three are gathered together, as touching and agreeing on anything, that you would hear from heaven and you would answer our prayers. God, there's more than two or three. And God, we believe in the power of prayer. As I preached this morning, we believe if we tell it to you, if we trust it with you, that God, you'll fix it. God, we come telling you our heart tonight. What's the heaviest thing? And we're going to trust you, God, to answer that prayer. Thank you for the prayers, God, that you've already answered. And for the prayers that you're going to answer. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Before you leave, you get up, go back and you see. I've got something I want to say. Thank you so much. That's what the altar's for. Thank you for coming down. We all need prayer. I need prayer. I hope some of you prayed for me. I hope some of you prayed for me. My wife. We're no different than anybody else. We need